Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Heights Baptist Church. If you would stand with me and take your hymnals, turn to page number 88. Page number 88 in your hymnals and sing the first, second, and last verse of I Sing the Mighty Power of God. Page number 88. Good to have everybody here in church this morning. Y'all looking great this morning, looking fine. All right, on the first verse, page 88.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad, and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to
now. Please remain standing for our scripture reading.
Let's take your Bibles this morning and turn to 1 John chapter 4, verses 11 through 15. 1 John 4, 11 through 15. Heavenly love was all that could help me. I was astray, so sad and alone. I looked above, my burdens all left me. Now I can say, heaven's my home. 1 John 4, beginning verse 11 through verse 15. As we begin, Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's good to be home. I've often told the pastor I feel more related to this family than the one I just visited up north, but it's good to be home, be with you. And yes, it did snow. That's why they call it May, my brother said. It may rain, it may snow, it may, sun may shine, but whatever happens, happens. Now, can I take just a minute?
Sure.
The last time I was here, Brother Cole accused me of preaching. So today I got a joke for you. While we were in Ohio, I went to McDonald's and ate a kid's meal. Oh. And his mother got so mad at me, she slapped me. I didn't get that joke from Brother Dolph. I got it from my brother Jim. It's good to be back. Happy Mother's Day, all you mothers. God bless you. And the work that you do with your children, putting up with your husbands and their dads.
Amen.
God bless you. Let's pray. Our God in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And these souls that are gathered here in this place gather to worship you because you are worthy, but because we love you as well. It's our desire here today, Father, to bring you all the glory and the honor that you so richly deserve through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Bless us as we attempt to do that, that your Holy Spirit would have free reign in our hearts and through the preaching of the word, that your word would not return void, that it would accomplish the things and the purposes you have for it here today in our hearts. Those of us are gathered here today. Let your will be done. We thank you for the mothers that are present with us here today, and also those who are there with you in heaven. What a precious gift you've given to us through mothers who are faithful to train their children in the things of God. Bless them, Father.
Amen.
Bless us through our worship, that you would give us faith, wisdom, and by your grace and by your mercies, we would obey your will. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Sorry, I don't have any jokes for you this morning. Page 627 in your hymnals. Page 627, we'll sing all four verses of Happy the Home When God Is There. Page 627. Page 627.
Happy the home when God is there, and love fills every breast. When one their wish and one their prayer, and one their heavenly rest. Happy the
song for many of us here, but that's a pretty good one right there.
Thank you.
If you would stand with me again, take your hymnals, turn to page 633. Page 633, we'll sing A Christian Home. A Christian Home, we'll sing all three verses. Page 633.
Oh, give thy song.
And I really appreciate Brother Rick Michael, and I sure hope he finds some better jokes. Let's pray. Father, our hearts are warm by good mamas, good daddies who love their children. And Lord, today we celebrate around this world Mother's Day, and we pray especially for mothers. Lord, they have a hard job. That by your strength, by your spirit, they can not only succeed, but they could thrive for your will in their life. And we pray for that. We pray for strong women, strong mothers, that they would step up, Lord, as never before, to do the work of God and to stand tall for Christ and for their children. I pray that you'd help us to that end this day. Lord, that's certainly my aim that you've laid on my heart, and I intend to do it with your grace and help. And I ask that all who are here would listen to God's word, heed it, and obey it, and go forth from this place stronger because of our time together. I pray that you'd bless the gifts of our members. Lord, help us to be faithful and true and grow in this grace also. And we pray, Father, you'd be pleased with our worship and our time together teaching your holy word. Stir our hearts now for you and for our families and for the children. In Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Brother Cameron and Gina are back from their travels. She's doing well, great with child, but no more dizziness, so we're happy about that. And from his haircut and Brother Micah's new haircut, it makes me want to go back and see the barber again, you know. Amen. All right. Well, happy Mother's Day. It's a great day in the Lord. Genesis chapter 3, please. Genesis chapter 3. You ladies look lovely. God bless you for doing so. I'd rather you look pretty than ugly any day. Amen. Amen. I remember Brother Frank Shiver, you know, boy, I miss him. His boy asked him, said, after his wife died in that bad automobile accident, he married Miss Bonnie. Of course, he was in his 80s. Miss Bonnie's in her 60s, so she was a young woman, you know. And his son said, Dad, why'd you marry such a young woman, you know? Your mom, Dad, why'd you marry such a young woman? He said, for the simple reason I like the smell of perfume better than Ben Gay. Amen. It has been well said that the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. The question remains, however, who's rocking the cradle these days? Who's rocking the cradle these days? The government has so managed the economy in the United States that many, many homes cannot function without both the husband and the wife holding down full-time jobs. Some more than one job. The result of this, children were sent off to daycare, later school, and summers were altogether a scramble. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? And looking for camps and vacation Bible schools and everything else. Meanwhile, government aid by redistribution policies, really, and printing press, government aid through the years has become stronger and stronger, aiding families more and more and more and more. School breakfasts, school lunch, summer lunch, books, food stamps, social programs, medical programs, dental programs, job training, housing vouchers, and more. While certainly compassionate to some degree, it has also resulted in government propagating widespread dependency and claiming more and more control over people's lives and children in these United States. More and more the government grows and grows to act like, sound like, smell like everything and everyone belongs to the state or is obligated to the nth degree to the state. Personal liberty is shrinking in this country now for years, and so is family autonomy. It has both been taken and freely given, perhaps in ignorance, perhaps without understanding, but it's been freely given. Each family is certainly not like an island to themselves. We are connected by community. We're connected to our neighbors, common citizenship, and more. Yet each family is an individual family. Each family is an individual family. A group of families make up a church. A group of families. A group of families make up a town, a city. A group of families make up a state and even a nation. Certainly, single adults may constitute a family unit, and that adult is one, but they are, if one, autonomous. They are a family, not property of the state. not property of the state. Not property of the state. We're getting there. Maybe fourth time's a charm. Not property of the state.
Amen.
Now I want to say carefully some things this morning. A school teacher is one of the most honorable professions, trades, activities a man or a woman may do with their life. We should not stand by and allow good teachers to be tarred and feathered with the same brush over against those who would do and say things that are improper and certainly not decent. And I'm going to say this, and I would say this, that good teachers ought to be honored, they ought to be respected, they ought to be protected, and I would say that even if we did not have teachers in our church. Recently, President Joe Biden gave a speech honoring the nation's teacher of the year. And that in and of itself is a proper thing to do. The President of the United States quoted this teacher saying himself, "There is no such thing as someone else's child. There's no such thing as someone else's child." Now hear me out, please. Let me be clear. Hear me out. Clubs call those who are members our members. Have done so for years and years and years. Civic leaders call their people my people. My people. Coaches call their team my kids. And have done so for years and years. Teachers historically have called their students my kids. Historically. Now there is certainly a quality to that ownership, or perhaps better said, the quality of belonging. The quality of belonging. When I went to Fernandina Beach High School, I was a pirate, a mighty pirate. Arr, the mighty pirate. I belong there. I was a member of that school. And I was a team player. I wanted our team to win. At everything. I have enough sense to root for the home team. Those who educate children, who throw themselves into the lives of children through the years, have often out of passion and out of sense even of a calling on their lives. Refer to the children in their class as their kids. And this has never been a problem. It's never been a problem all through the years because common sense was more common. Because common sense was more common. Those teachers and the parents of the children knew full well that teachers were taking pride in their work, ownership of their class, stewardship of their class with their children, and the parents were grateful for the lives and investment in their children. And everything was just fine. Just fine. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Everything was just fine. For years, teachers would say, "My kids, my class." And it never meant anything what it has become to be twisted to be today by some. It never meant what it has become to mean by some. By some. Twisted, power-hungry individuals and groups, organizations, and people today, yes, even government. Reasonable-minded people sense that something else is taking place here. Don't you? It's not just a teacher saying, "My kids," and the way it used to be. Not quite that, is it? They sense something else has taken place today that was not taking place years ago. More and more moms and dads are growing alarmed. And they sense something else is being pushed, at least in some circles. Something else is afoot. Something else is being pushed behind closed doors. And it stinks all the way to hell and back. And they don't like the smell of it. And you shouldn't. We're not talking about child abuse here when the government must step in to protect a child. That's not what we're talking about. Our president, in the same speech, then repeated it, and he said, there's no such thing as someone else's child. And then he continued, our nation's children are all our children. Our nation's children are all our children. End quote. You have to let that soak in a little bit. Our president may be indeed suffering from some impairments. But not so much, excuse me, teachers, that he does not, double negatives, realize exactly what he was saying and who he was saying it to, and knowing full well that it's going to be broadcast to the rest of the people of this nation. He hasn't lost his marbles that much. That much. It was one thing for teachers of past years to say, my kids at school, yet tens of thousands of mommies and daddies start to feel and believe something is a bit different today. And you do. You feel it. You feel it in your bones. You sense it. When a teacher tells a student, you can change your pronouns, and but don't tell your mommy. You don't have to say anything about this to your mom and dad. You can start changing your body, but don't tell your mom. Don't tell your mom. It's okay. We'll show you how to wear these things. If you're confused about your sex, it means you're trans. I've never known too many children who were not confused about sex. You can go to the art club, which is not an art club. But you don't need to tell your parents what the teacher is actually discussing in art class, which is not art class. Because they will not support you, but we will. We are your friends. We understand. We know what you should be taught, not them. Now, friends, that's entirely a different matter. And few know that better than the good teachers in this land. They know full well. They know probably better than most. For good many years now, good teachers have been begging for stronger parental involvement with the children of the classrooms. Begging for parents to be more involved. Years ago, I was involved, and I belonged to what was called then, I don't know if it's still that way today, you teachers could tell me, the campus improvement team. Did they still have a campus improvement teams? And I was a part of that for 2 years in one of the schools there at our city in Garland. And both of those years, back to back, the school won what was called the Governor's Award and received extra funds and some perks and all because of that. The number one reason that school won the Governor's Award 2 years back to back was stronger parental involvement. Number one reason. And that's what we worked for from the first day that we met to the last day we met. Stronger parental involvement. So I'm going to take my time today to drive home one point. It's not 3 points in a poem. One point. that all right with you? Go to Genesis chapter 3. You're already there. Genesis chapter 3, beginning at verse 22. It's what the Word of God says. And the Lord God said, Behold, the man is become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. Chapter 4, verse 1. And Adam knew, remember the Bible's a polite book? Adam knew Eve, his wife. And she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. Now here we have recorded for our benefit, if we'll have the mind to see and understand, we have the history of humankind, of mankind. God created Adam and Eve. Male and female created he them. Male, female. Female, male. Male, female. Two. Distinct. Male, female. Created he them. You would think teachers could count as high as two. I think they can. Adam, the first man, knew Eve, his wife, a female, a woman, an adult female. He knew her in the covenant of marriage, and she conceived. She went through pregnancy, those special 9 months, and many right here know all too well about, carrying their child, and she gave birth first to Cain, and this is what she said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. I have gotten a man from the Lord, singular, I. And she again bears brother Abel, and she could have said the same thing. Again, I have gotten another man. I have gotten a man from the Lord. Or she could have said, we have gotten a man from the Lord, because it certainly takes two. And it must be a male and a female. I said it must be a male and a female. The rest is all a con. It's a con. And I've got support for that. The Bible is called confusion. It's con, to confuse, to put two things together that don't belong together, and there will be no fruit, though they pretend that there will be. Confusion. I have gotten a man from the Lord. So she could have said, we have gotten a man from the Lord, but by then they had two small children running around their feet. So there's really no time for long commentary anymore. I've got children to take care of. I don't have time to tell you all what's happened. Y'all are going to have to read about it in the papers later on. Let somebody else write the book. I've got children to raise. Amen? God did not wait for government before children were given. And they were not needed. God knows what he's doing. They were not needed. All that God needed was a mom and a daddy. And he gave these two boys a mother and a father, a male and a female, a husband and a wife. Now with two children. And it will be up to them to take care of those children. There's nobody else. It'll be up to them to take care of their own children. It's up to them to watch out over all things pertaining to the welfare of those children's lives. They're boys. If their two boys ate, it's because they fed them. They fed them. They fed them. If those two boys were taught anything, it's because their mothers and fathers taught them. Those two boys were spanked on the rump. It's because mom and dad spanked them on the rump. Amen. If these boys had chores to do and they
were responsible to do it is because their parents gave them chores and said, this is the law of the Medes and Persians, and it will be done, or you'll be found in the balance as wanting, and your hind end won't be worth shucks. These two boys had questions about how they came into this world. What was their purpose in life? It would be up to their mom and dad to attend to those important matters. Anyone who suggests that children do not belong to their own normal moms and dads is of the devil. They're of the devil. Malachi 4 verse 5 and 6. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Catch me if you would in Psalm 128. Psalm 128. Let me show you a few, just a little bit out of the book. Is that all right? Yes. Right out of the book of God. At the end of the day, that's really what it's all about. Psalm 128, verse 1. A song of degrees. Blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord, that walketh in his ways. For thou shalt eat the labor of thy hands, happy shalt thou be. What? Eat the labor of the hands. You enjoy what you work for. And it shall be well with thee. Amen. Thy wife. If it starts in the King James Bible, it starts with a T, it's singular. It starts with a Y, it's plural. Thy, singular. Thy wife. One man, one woman. Amen. One man, one woman. Thy wife shall be as a fruitful vine by the sides of thine house. Thy, singular, children like olive plants round about thy table. Behold, that thus shall the man be blessed that feareth the Lord. The Lord shall bless thee out of Zion, and thou shalt see the good of Jerusalem all the days of thy life. Yea, thou shalt see thy children's children, and peace upon Israel. So again, thy singular children, like olive plants round about your table. Thou shalt see thy children's children. Your own children shall be like olive plants round about, lovely plants around your own table. Sounds good, doesn't it? Your children, you'll see your children and your children's children. In other words, your grandbabies. Amen. Your grandbabies. Proverbs 13:24 says, he that spareth his rod hateth his son. His son possesseth his son. But he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. I do acknowledge the village exists. And I did read Mrs. Clinton's book. I did. I thought if I was going to criticize it, in all fairness, I ought to read the book. I think that's reasonable. I think it's just. I do recognize that there is a village. But the village should be the cheerleaders of good mamas and daddies. Cheerleaders. But they have no ownership over someone else's child. Period. It does not take a village to raise a child. It takes a mom and a daddy. And I'll go so far even today, I know it's Mother's Day, but if the dad's not in the picture, it's going to be sad singing and slow marching. The Bible says in Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. That training, the priority, the spearhead of that training is to be led by mom and dad. Amen. Mom and dad. It's a responsibility of mothers and fathers. Proverbs 15:20, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despiseth his mother. This whole movement about the pop culture of teaching children to despise their parents is right out of hell. It's Satan's playbook. That's Satan's playbook. That's not God's playbook. That's Satan's playbook. Catch me in Ephesians 6. Just give you some things over in the New Testament. Just in case you think I'm just leaning on the Old Testament a little bit too much. Ephesians 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Well, if it's right, certainly not wrong. Honor thy father and mother. Singular. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. Verse 4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. God has given parents the authority over their own children. Not over others' children. Not over others' children. And it's our responsibility to teach our children to obey the Lord and do the obedience even to mom and dad in the Lord, in the fear of God. To honor the father and mother that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. The idea is that we encourage daddies and moms to care about their own children and teach the children they should love, respect, and revere their mamas and daddies. That's God's order. That's God's order. And if you get that out of whack, it's out of order. It's out of order. Turn to Proverbs 17, please. Proverbs 17. Short of Proverbs, a short-tiered saying with a general meaning of truth conveyed in it. And Proverbs 17:6 is no exception. Proverbs 17:6 says this, children's children are the crown of old men. And the glory of children are their fathers. Children's children are the crown of old men. The glory of the children are their fathers. It was offered, this truism is illustrated by every grandfather or grandmother who just happens to have a handy picture of their grandchild. Just so happens to have a handy picture. Have you seen the yokels walking around here the last couple of weeks? Have you seen a picture of my grandbaby? Have you seen a picture of my grandbaby? Now, it used to be wallet. You know, have you seen a picture? Just hold the phone up. Have you seen a picture of it? Look here. I've got more. Have you been on Facebook? I've got a lot more. How many can you take? Well, that's not enough. Amen. That's not enough. The second clause. The glory of children are their fathers. Now, we kind of still hold on to that first part. Children's children are the crown of old men. We love our children. We especially love our grandbabies. Yeah. Yeah. Well, what about the glory of children are their fathers? We've kind of lost something there. I said, we kind of lost something there. So let's, what does that mean? It means, in God's order, children should love and revere and all but worship the ground that of their mothers and the fathers, the ground that they walk on. Amen. We've come a long way from that, haven't we? Well, who's behind that? Well, ultimately, Satan's behind that. Satan's behind that. We love the days when the little ones are trying on mama's and daddy's shoes and they can't wait to grow up to be like daddy. And they cannot wait to grow up and be like mommy. That's God's order. That's God's order. And we're a long ways from that. It's been illustrated in this story. I love it. So I'll give it to you. The boys were bragging about their daddies, you know. The farmer's boy said, my dad raised a big wheat crop and bought a new car. Boy, that's good. Bought a new car. Of course, that would be a truck probably, so I need to amend that story a little bit. The professor's son said, my dad was just elected president of the university. The doctor's son said, that's nothing. My dad did a heart transplant in one day and made $20,000 in one day. The lawyer's boy said, you think that's big? My dad won a lawsuit, made $100,000. preacher's boy. He said, you haven't heard anything yet. My dad preaches in a big church. He talks for just a few minutes and it takes 16 men to carry the money out. The point of the story, they're proud and love their daddies. Children should be proud of their mamas and daddies. And they ought to love them. And they ought to revere them. Not worship them, but revere them. Revere them. You say, well, you know, my dad wasn't perfect. Neither was mine. Neither was mine. But it's still good for us. And all more so if we have a godly mom and godly dad. Grandfathers, by the way, with the Jews, they were called the old men. So if you're responding, it wasn't a slight. It wasn't, oh, the old man. It wasn't any of that. The old men, when they spoke about the old men, they were talking about granddaddies. Granddaddies, grandfathers. Still to be considered a great glory when grandfathers see their children and their children's children walking in the Lord. Proud grandparents. Colossians 3:18, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. You say, why do you include that? Because I'm preaching. I get to include what I want. Amen. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things. Sounds pretty clear to me. For this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Back over in the Old Testament, let me go back there one more time. Deuteronomy chapter 4, if you would. Deuteronomy 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4, let's begin in verse 7. You there yet? Miss Andrew's not here, so I'll have to look to Brother Russ. I don't know if he's quite as slow as Miss Andrew, but you know, I'm kidding. Deuteronomy chapter 4, look at verse 7. For what nation is there so great, who hath God so nigh unto them, as the Lord our God is in all things, that we call upon him poor? And what nation is there so great, that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? Only take heed to thyself, and keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget the things which thine eyes have seen, and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life. But teach them thy sons, and thy sons' sons. Especially the day that thou stoodest before the Lord thy God in Horeb, when the Lord said unto me, gather me the people together, and I will make them hear my words, that they may learn to fear me all the days that they shall live upon the earth. And that they may teach their children. They may teach their children. They, parents, may teach their children. The hope of America lies greatly with parents. Moms and dads. Not two moms and two dads. But moms and dads who are walking faithfully in God's word, in God's way, in Christ, in truth, training up their own children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Our hope. Parents, mamas, daddies, who would dare to walk into a public meeting and say, not here. And stomp their little foot, say, my children do not belong to you. God gave my children to me and my husband. God gave these children to me and their mama. With all due respect, if you insist, there's going to have to be some changes. But don't tell me that my children belong to you. I certainly can't embrace, and we would all embrace, you just turn back the clock and nobody had an issue with that. You want teachers to have an ownership of their class. You want that. But they use things that would normally sound just fine, and the next thing you know, they root in. And they corrupt something that was good. They take something that was beautiful, and they make it ugly. Why? So they can slip in and start indoctrinating the children against the law and the ways of God. And that's of the devil. And it has to be called out privately and publicly. It has to be called out. And we need to have enough spiritual courage, physical courage even perhaps, to do that very thing. I pointed out the other day about this young girl, Miss Gaines, this swimmer, university swimmer. I said, God bless her. May God increase her tribe. And now she's called for, and I'm for it. Those girls that work so hard to get where they are, don't swim. Don't compete. Walk off. Walk off. Walk off. You'll stop the whole meet. Don't worry about that. The whole meet will stop. And the people responsible for that foolishness, they'll have a change of heart. Walk off. And that's a hard call. And it calls for people of good, strong character to do it. And I hope they do it. I hope they do it. Walk off. But she didn't go to first base. She went on around first and started heading to second. Gotta like her, man. Gotta like her. I like her. She says, okay, Miss Serena, the big, great tennis player who said, I think it was her or her sister, said if she played against one of the leading tennis players, male tennis players of the world, the match would go like this, 6-0, 6-0, 6-0. In other words, that man would leave her in the dust. Much stronger. Hits the ball much harder. Leave her in the dust. There'd be no competition whatsoever. So now this Miss Gaines is calling out such leaders, such athletic leaders of the nation. Take a stand. Take a stand. The whole world knows this isn't fair. It's not righteous. It's not just. Where are all the feminists? The whole world knows this is not right. Certainly God's children ought to know that that's not right. Let girls compete against girls. And let boys compete against boys. And everybody else, get in the stand. Get in the stand. When you get that straightened out, maybe you can get out here on the court. I can live with that all day long. You say, well, we ought to have a division. Why do you want to have a division for freaks? You start one division, you go down that path, where are you going to end? There will be another set of freaks, and another set of freaks, and another set of freaks. Happy Mother's Day. Let's stand. Let's stand. 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 God help us. We need His help. One thought. God gave children to mamas and daddies. Amen. That's God's word. Amen. And don't you let anybody tell you anything different. Let's pray. Lord of heaven, bless us and help us to stand strong in Your word and not back down and not back up. Help us have the love of Jesus in our heart for all people, saved and lost alike. But help us not to ever cave on Your truth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
273, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Page 273.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at a throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
All right, there you are. That's a little bit different Mother's Day message, isn't it? Well, tonight we're going to have Brother Rob with two B's, actually. That's Brother Gabe's fault. He didn't catch that. I'll blame him. But Miss Janine was quick to point out my error. You know, I just want y'all to know that. That's free. But Brother Daniel is going to be preaching for us tonight. And I wish Miss Janine this morning, she walked in and said, Happy Mother's Day on two different counts. Happy Mother's Day. And then your son's here. By the way, and I didn't know he was coming. Everybody else seemed to know in the whole world except me. She said, I told you what she said 2 months ago. That's a whole lifetime ago. 2 months ago, you told me my son's coming to town. No, she didn't say that. But he's going to preach tonight. And yeah, I'm going to give him a gift. Okay. You know, he was out of work there for a little while. And have you noticed she's also got a bump? Okay. So we're going to bless him. Okay. That all right with you? Amen. Their own, you know. So we'll be a blessing to him. I know that you'll be here tonight to hear him preach. And this is, of course, Mother's Day, and as is and has been our tradition for quite some time, we have a special rose, a single rose for all of you mothers. Okay? And you say, well, I don't yet have a baby. If you have a baby in your belly, you have a baby. You have a baby. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, that's a baby.
Amen.
That's a baby. That's a baby.
Amen.
All right. Happy Mother's Day to you, too. All right. Tonight, chiropractic is going to be 5 o'clock. We're going to not have chiropractic. No, ladies, it's like, man, you get it so good. Happy Mother's Day. No choir practice. Play hooky. Okay? And we'll see you at 6 o'clock. Amen?
Amen.
God bless you. Thank you for being here with us today. Oh, I forgot about the most important thing. Brother Mark said, hey, we're forgetting somebody right here. Brother Colin, well, he's, you know. Brother Colin has decided to move down here. He is a present member of Southwest Baptist Church there in Oklahoma City. And he'd like to come down and unite, not as an intern, but to unite with New Heights Baptist Church. Do we have a motion to receive this man in our church? All in favor, say amen.
Amen.
Give you the opportunity to come around, shake his hand, hug his neck, whatever you want to do, belly bump, that's okay too. And welcome him into our church family. And that's what it is. It's a family.
Amen.
It is. It's a family. And I certainly love our family. I hope you love me too, at least a little bit. Yeah, at least a little bit. All right, God bless you. Brother Colt, come say whatever you want. Again, happy Mother's Day to all you mothers.
Thank God for mommies, because if it was left up to just daddies, I don't think we'd make it. Oh, man. A couple things. We got a few sign-up sheets out in the foyer, one for a shower, and then we have a yard sale sign-up. Yard sale, you can still bring your items this week. Next week is whenever we're sorting on Monday, Tuesday, and then selling the weekend. So we got a sign-up sheet for that, a sign-up sheet for the tubing trip coming up next month, not July, but June. And then also a sign-up for the interns out there. They're going to be here next Sunday. It's their first Sunday starting next weekend. So we have a sign-up sheet for meals and stuff out there for Sunday afternoons and all that. So sign up for that. No choir practice tonight, but ladies' ensemble does have to practice. So we'll practice really quick right after the service. Okay, can we do that? Make that work? No? Okay. All right. All right. We'll do that. All right, let's go ahead and close in prayer. Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the message this morning. Lord, we thank you for every mother that's here. Bless them and give them grace that they need. And we praise you for giving us mothers and giving us good and godly mothers. Thank you for my mom. Just be with all of them today and give them an extra special blessing. We thank you for just being with us in the service this morning. Just be with Brother Colin as he's moving down here. And thank you for him joining the church. And be with the interns coming next week and all the other stuff going on, Lord. We thank you and praise you for your blessings. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.